Okay, so this is chapter 30, and this is the hepatobiliary. So we're talking about the liver, and we're talking about bile, and then we're going to talk a little bit about the pancreas and the gallbladder as well. So since we're focusing mainly on the liver, one of the main functions, or one of the functions of the liver that's actually associated with GI function, is bile production, because that bile is then going to be excreted, and you can kind of see it's made in the liver. So bile is made in the liver. We'll say a little bit more about that. It's forming the conjugated form, which is more soluble. So bile is made in the liver, and then it kind of moves down here, and then it's stored in the gallbladder. Okay, and then when you have a big fatty meal, then this gallbladder will contract, and it will excrete, I guess, this bile into the intestine, and then the intestine, that the bile salts that are in the bile will help digest fatty meals. And there's so bile consists of a lot of things. I mean, it's more than just bilirubin and bile salts. There are other things. There's cholesterol that's excreted in it as well. And it's just kind of another way that your body can kind of get rid of stuff that's floating around in the blood, and move it out to move it into the digestion. So there are a lot of things that are insoluble in water that will then be excreted through bile, as opposed to some other things that are more soluble that can be excreted through urine. Okay, so it's just kind of a different class of molecules that can then be excreted through here. But the important things really are bilirubin that's excreted, and then the bile salts, which are then used for digestion. Okay, so drug and hormone metabolism happens here as well. Happens in the liver, and so biotransformation into water-soluble forms, detoxification, inactivation. And we'll see how some of that stuff takes place. And so if we look at, so here's portal circulation. This is actually kind of interesting, and this is actually a really good picture too, because what it's showing is it's showing all of these connections. So here's your GI system. So you have your stomach, your pancreas, it's both the large and the small intestine. And we know that absorption of food happens in these places. So we have molecules that are broken down in digestion, and then they're absorbed. And you can see that this absorption goes directly to the liver. Okay, so it goes directly to the liver, and why that's important is because when we absorb food through the intestines, we're getting more maybe than just molecules that we want. And so rather than your body just dumping those things into general circulation where they can cause some harm, it tries to shuttle them off directly to the liver, so the liver can sort of detoxify anything that shouldn't be there and break it down. And so we call this portal circulation, or the portal system. So blood from the digestive system carries absorbed materials to the liver through the hepatic portal vein, and that's what this is. So you can see that as these things are being absorbed, they move to the liver, and then the liver can get the first shot at trying to break anything down that might be toxic. So how does it do that, and how does the liver work in general? This is actually a really good picture to look at, because it kind of gives, if you sort of look through it, you can kind of see exactly what's going on. So blood from the hepatic portal vein and hepatic artery mix. Okay, so there's a blood supply of oxygenated blood that just came from the heart that's going in here. Okay, so into the hepatic artery, and then we have that stuff that just came from the digestive tract that's going into the portal vein. Okay, and so that moves through. So both of these things move through, and then they mix, and they will then be. And this is kind of the important thing, is all these cells that are lined up and surrounding it, all of the molecules that just moved in through both the arterial and from that portal vein, have close access to these cells. And these cells are producing enzymes, and they're trying to break down anything that shouldn't be there. And they may be excreting bile. vacuoles. So hepatic cells lie along sinusoids. Okay, so these are the sinusoids. That's what it moves into. Pick up chemicals from blood, modify blood's composition. So it's basically breaking things down that shouldn't be there and adding things that it wants to have there. Okay, so because a lot of proteins that are involved in things like clotting are made by these hepatocytes or these liver cells. Okay, so many sinusoids come together to empty into one vein, okay, here, and then that will then go off to the heart and then be put into general circulation. So you can kind of think of this as like this little conveyor line, and there are lots of them all over the liver, and that's where things are getting broken down and things are being excreted. Things that need to be in the blood and things that you don't want in the blood are all just sort of going through this vetting process where so to make sure that it's kind of cleaning the blood in a very simple way to put that. Okay, so sinusoids empty into the central vein, sends blood to the hepatic vein and the inferior vena cava. At the back, so if we kind of erase these little guys here, on the other side of these, you have bile that's being released into these little yellow, I don't want to call them veins, they're ducts. So these little ducts here that are canaliculi, that the bile is being released, and so these are some of the waste products that are just being sort of put into these bile ducts or these canaliculi that then drain to the bile duct. Okay, and that's how your bile is produced. Okay, so that's kind of a nice little way to think about how all this stuff is taking place. You've got a pretty good system. And so we always talk about how these proteins are being made in the liver and things are being cleaned by the liver. Well, that's how it does it. It just runs a very small little vein or veinule along here. And then just allows access. And so all of these enzymes that the liver is producing, because that's their job, are cleaning that up. Okay, so then bile that's being put into these canaliculi are then put into the bile duct, and then that bile duct goes to the gallbladder, and then later the gallbladder will squeeze it out when it gets a cholecystokinin or CCK signal saying, hey, it's time to work. Okay. So metabolic functions of the liver, we've talked about a lot of these things. Carbohydrate, protein, lipid metabolism, the liver does a whole lot of stuff. So glucose is one of these things that will, when you get it in your diet or when you have too much in your circulation, this glucose will be taken up into cells and stored as glycogen. And then it can be released too. So when your blood glucose levels are low, you can take that gly your liver cells will take that glycogen and then squirt it into your blood, and then you have glucose there and available. Now, one of the other things that happens is when you have too much glucose or the glycogen stores are kind of getting filled up, then it'll start making fatty acids. And then those fatty acids, I don't know if you remember talking about the VLDLs, then those fatty acids will form these lipoproteins, and then those lipoproteins will go off and those will be released by the liver, and those will then go off to adipose tissue or wherever you might need some triglycerides or cholesterol. Cholesterol is made there too. So all of these things can be made in those cells that we just saw. Let's see. So different ways that, I mean, lots of stuff can be happened. Glucose, if you remember gluconeogenesis, you can have amino acids. If you're really, really low on glucose, you might even be able to form glucose from amino acids or other substrates like fats and stuff like that. Okay, so what does it do with lipids? We already kind of mentioned that. Lipids oxidized for energy. Synthesize, so lipids can be made there. That's what I was kind of just saying. Also, the glucose can be converted into fats, and then packaged into those lipoproteins. Cholesterol is also made in the liver. Protein synthesized from amino acids. So of course the liver cells are going to need proteins. Transamination and deamination. So now these are just fancy ways of saying that we're rearranging nitrogen groups, and it's probably a good thing to remember that when we talk about nitrogen And we talk about things like NH3, that those are what are amines. So all of these things like amino acids and well, I was going to say urea, but that doesn't have the word amine in it. But all of these things have nitrogen. Azo. Azo is another term for nitrogen compounds, not necessarily NH3, but these are all nitrogen based. Okay. So ammonia is NH4, or the ammonium ion is MH4. So all of these things, nitrogen based. Yeah, it's just a good thing to remember because when we think of nitrogen, we should be thinking about amino acids primarily. Okay, so one of the other things we've already talked about is jaundice. Okay. Jaundice is that yellowish discoloration to the skin and deep tissues, and it is caused or it results from an accumulation of bilirubin. Okay, so bilirubin is a what you would call a pigment. It's a yellow color. And so you can see that when it builds up, then it will impart a yellow color to the skin, the sclera of the eyes. It's because there is too much. And so one of the things that the liver does is it converts that conjugated form into an unconjugated form, sorry, into a conjugated form. Okay, so the unconjugated form is what's floating around. Okay, so it's floating around in your blood, and it will tend to stick to the albumin. So remember now when we think about blood proteins, one of the main blood proteins is albumin. And so that bilirubin will stick to the albumin. And then it's the job of the liver to sort of conjugate that, to mix it with another molecule or combine it with another molecule that makes it soluble. And then once it's soluble, it can then be excreted in bile. Okay. So it basically conjugates it, which makes it soluble. Okay. And then that's excreted into bile. Before that, it's going to stick to plasma albumin. Okay. So that's kind of the quick way of saying that. Now, remember that bilirubin is made from broken down blood cells. So that heme group in the blood cells, that's what actually is chemically converted to bilirubin. And so you see bilirubin not just with jaundice, but when a bruise is healing. You know how a bruise, it starts out being kind of purple and those capillaries leak out blood cells and it sort of causes the bruise that we see. And then over time it starts to heal and those blood cells start to be broken down and it forms bilirubin in that area. And it causes the yellowing of bruises. Okay. So but we're interested in when it's sort of collecting in the blood. Okay. All right, so free unconjugated bilirubin transported in blood attached to plasma albumin. So we remember that. It's reported as indirect bilirubin. Conjugated bilirubin is released from albumin as soluble and is soluble in bile. Okay, so the conjugated bilirubin is the one that's turned into this soluble form, and then it's released in the bile. Okay. So, we are going to when we think about the liver, when it comes to pathology, we tend to think about things like hepatitis and then cirrhosis, which is an advanced form. So hepatitis is an inflammation, and then cirrhosis is when that starts to kind of some of that tissue kind of dies and then is replaced by scar tissue, and so cirrhosis is a bit more of an advanced phase, okay, of liver disease. So hepatitis. Okay, so we have to be very, very careful with this because we know that hepatitis can be caused by viruses, and we have a whole list of the hepatitis viruses here. But hepatitis isn't necessarily a viral disease. It can be caused by viruses, but hepatitis itself is just a group of disease characterized by inflammation of the liver. Okay, so it can be caused by viruses, and that is the most common. Okay, and we see here 15,000 deaths annually in the US. But it can also be caused by reactions to chemical agents like alcohol. So alcohol can lead to hepatitis, drugs, other toxins. Autoimmune disorders can lead to hepatitis. Okay, so anything that's causing that inflammation of the liver. Infectious agents, including mononucleosis, salmonella, amoebas can all these are other types of infections. So I mean, here we even have bacteria that can cause this. And so really anything that causes this inflammation in the liver, and that's what we classify as hepatitis. So we don't want to get too we're going to focus on that for many of these slides, but we don't want to get too focused on the fact that most of the time hepatitis is caused by a virus, because hepatitis can be caused by other things as well. Okay, so viral hepatitis varies in modes of transmission, incubation period, degree of damage, and whether or not it's chronic or more acute. Okay, so hepatitis, mechanisms of injury. It can be a direct cellular injury, so we're damaging the cells directly, or it can be immune mediated. So that means that immune cells, immunoglobulins, IgGs, can build up, and those can actually cause damage as well. So we can have our own immune system may start to affect the ability of these cells to survive in the liver. And so our own immune system may contribute to hepatitis. So the clinical course, as we said, varies. It can be an asymptomatic infection with seroconversion. And seroconversion just means that time when the antibody develops and then becomes detectable. So we have an infection, and then that is that then we see a point where the antibody can be tested in a blood test. Okay, so this is an example of an immune response. Okay. So immune mediated mechanism of injury. So acute symptomatic phase. So this is also associated with infections. And then there is a carrier state without clinically apparent disease or with chronic hepatitis, and this is also involved in infectious. So that means that we have, let's say maybe we have a virus and we don't have any apparent disease, even though we could, I guess is the way to say that. There could be some disease, and it may come back, or it may not, but either way you still have the disease, and you are a carrier. So that means that if you're a carrier, you can transmit this disease to someone else. And then chronic hepatitis. So that means that the symptoms of hepatitis are there. There's damage. There's continuous inflammation. Whereas before, maybe if it's asymptomatic or like in the carrier state, you won't see the inflammation. With chronic hepatitis, the inflammation is there, but it may or may not progress to cirrhosis. All right, and then fulminating disease. Fulminating disease with rapid onset of liver failure is infectious. So we might think of that as like a toxin, like Tylenol. Tylenol can cause damage, and it's usually rapid onset, and rapid onset of liver failure. So so vaccinations are available for Hep A and Hep B, okay, and you've probably gotten those vaccinations. Those are available to the general public. Studies are being done to get a hepatitis C vaccine, but that's not quite there yet. So, and there's really no cure, because we're talking really about viruses, and one thing that we haven't really figured out yet is a way to reliably cure viruses. There are antiviral medications that can sort of slow it down, which can help your own immune system sometimes take out a virus. But there hasn't been anything like we see with antibiotics. There isn't anything for viruses, so it shouldn't be any surprise that there's no cure for any of the viral hepatitis diseases. So if we look at the different viral hepatitises, I think that's the plural for that. We have hepatitis A, so A, B, C, D, and E. Okay. Remember A and B, there are vaccines that are available for it. So there are a few things to look at. I'm not too worried about this column here as to whether you know exactly what the virus looks like or what kind of virus it is. That might be important for other things, but not for us right now. The things to look at really are transmission. Transmission is kind of a big one because hepatitis A is the fecal-oral route. Okay? And so when you're talking about fecal-oral, then you tend to relate that to poor sanitation. Okay? So that's going to be a problem in regions where sanitation is a problem, where feces is being put into the rivers or drinking water or something like that. You don't have a good way to isolate those things. So hepatitis A usually benign and self-limiting. Okay, so a lot of the people in these regions have had hepatitis A. They've developed antibodies to it. They've gotten over it, and so they can't get it again. But then if someone who hasn't been exposed goes there, then they're going to have to go through that as well. And it can cause damage. It's not like, a cold or something. It actually can cause liver damage, and people can have different responses to that. Okay, Hep B can cause both acute and chronic. So type A was acute. We can pretty much say that. Hep B can be acute or chronic, and it tends to become chronic when you have co-infection with hepatitis D down here. Okay, so hepatitis D and hepatitis B kind of work together, and that's one of the ways that they discovered hepatitis D is because they figured out that when they were looking at hepatitis B, a lot of times when it went to that chronic phase, that hepatitis D was also present. There was a different virus that was present there as well. Okay, so can be acute or chronic. Parenteral, that means that it's anything that's not related to GI. So that means blood, oral or sexual contact, mother to infant. So anything, it's not GI, whereas Hep A, remember, was fecal oral. So that wouldn't apply to Hep B. Okay, and yes, and like I said, vaccine is available. You can be a carrier with that one. Hep C, often asymptomatic early, but causes chronic hepatitis. Okay, so that's a problem. Okay, so it's that's one of those things we need to kind of think about. Chronic hepatitis is associated with Hep C. The transmission is blood to blood, and no vaccine is available for this one. Hep D requires Hep B to propagate. So you can't have Hep you can have Hep B without Hep D, but you can't have Hep D without Hep B. That was fun to say. So co-infection with Hep B increases the risk of liver cancer. So when you have this, it tends to be more chronic, and we see a higher incidence of liver cancer. Okay, so similar transmission, so parenteral transmission, not GI related. Hep E causes acute and self-limiting infection. So this is also acute. With low mortality, and it tends to be it's self-limiting, low mortality. Immunocompromised people can develop chronic, but in general, it's considered more of an acute type of virus. And again, just like Hep A, it's mainly fecal-oral, and it's associated, of course, when we talk about fecal-oral, we're going to be looking at sanitation, okay? And regions that have difficulty with sanitation. Now, the differences between these, the reasons this, and like I said, you don't have to know the different viruses, but these viruses are all different, and some of them have very different structures. So single-stranded, double-stranded. So the rest of these are single-stranded RNA. I'm not even sure what Hep E is, whether it, but it must be an RNA virus as well, because it's single-stranded. Well, I mean, not because it's single-stranded, but you don't have to know these, but that's the different classifications are based on the fact that they are different viruses that are doing the infection. So they're not all the same virus, obviously. So if we look, we'll look at a little bit about the sequence at which these things cause infection. So Hep A, 25 to 30 day incubation period. So that's that period of time from the point of exposure to where you actually start showing symptoms and becoming infectious. So fecal shedding occurs after the virus replicates in the liver and is excreted in the bile. Okay, so that's where it's excreted. This makes sense. It's a fecal-oral route. And so it's happening in the liver, and then the liver is allowing those virus molecules to move through the bile and into the GI system. Okay, so shedding may occur for 2 to 3 weeks before symptoms occur. So this is a problem. This is how, I mean, it's not the only way that people get infected, but it certainly increases the ease at which people can get infected because someone with it won't, may not even know that they have it, and they may be passing it on for a few weeks before they even know that it's there. So shedding is followed by the presence of the virus in the bloodstream, viremia, and so you can see that this is taking place before we even have antibodies. So then the IgM antibodies occur first, and then the IgG or the IgM occur first, and then kind of decrease. So IgM tend to be more associated with things like mucous membranes around the GI system, and then the IgG antibodies occur within 1 month, and then those are the ones that are going to persist. So the IgG are going to start to form, and then that's going to be the immunoglobulins or the antibodies that are floating around and providing that long-term protection. Okay, Hep B. So if we remember Hep B from our chart earlier, the incubation period is longer but varies, so 1.5 to 4 months. It's a more serious health problem. A third of the world has been infected, and it tends to be, I mean, if we look back, we tend to see that this is can be either acute or chronic. So there are, and the co-infection with Hep D, of course. So incubation period, three specific antigens. Now, the only reason we really care about these is because when we're doing like a blood test or something like that, we kind of want to know when we're seeing and what we're supposed to look at. And this, the antigen for Hep B is going to be the earliest one to appear. Okay, so the antigen to Hep B, that's right here. Okay, so that's the antigen. Now, the antigen is the thing that your immune system recognizes. So, let's see, HBS right here. And so that's more out here on the viral coat. And so that's the first one that appears. It's the one that's most measured. And then the antibody to that then appears at some point. And then, so after the clearance of, let's see, the S antigen and after immunization, so you'll start to see the anti-S. So the antibody against that S antigen. So the presence of the E antigen, so the Hep B E antigen indicates the virus is replicating, and that's probably because the Hep B E antigen, let's see, yeah, is kind of inside, so it's enclosed in that envelope, and so that means that the virus is breaking and out there in the blood, and the antibodies are breaking it down. So that's indicating that it is replicating. It's out there doing something. It's active. Okay, so these are the different things that we would look at. Okay, different parts of the virus. So not too worried about tripping you up on, where these things are happening, but just sort of understanding that these antibodies, antigens, are just part, the antigens are part of the virus, and the antibodies are the things that we have to measure to that we can also measure to figure out what's going on with these. Okay, Hep C, it's more chronic. So incubation of 2 to 26 weeks. So this really varies. There's an anti-Hep C antibody and so anti-HCV antibody and HCV are present. The virus RNA are present and measurable in the serum during the infection. So this is how we would test to see if someone has it and test to see, you know, how their progression is. Now, there's one other thing that is associated with Hep C, and that is the fact that exacerbations and remissions of clinical symptoms occur. Okay? And so there's so it may there you may be in remission for a little while, and then it may exacerbate, and it may go kind of go up and down. And the way to measure that is something is a protein that's found in the liver that tends to be released. Okay? And that's alanine aminotransferase or ALT. And so that's a blood test that would be done on someone with Hep C. You would be looking at that, and you would see that as l the liver is being damaged, these levels would increase, and then you may have a remission phase where it goes down, and then it just sort of may go up, down at, you know, random intervals, okay? Or maybe unpredictable intervals. And so you know, any kind of treatment or something like that, you can kind of see how that's going with a patient. Okay, so chronic viral hepatitis, so the ones, so those that are chronic, these are the principal causes of chronic liver disease, cirrhosis, so if it continues, and then cancer. So when we're talking about destroying cells and cell division, these cells are trying to adjust, then that may sort of they may sort of switch to a cancerous cell. So, and chronic, again, we're talking about chronic, not the acute viral hepatitises. Chief reason for liver transplants in adults, and these are viral or are chronic. Okay, so HBV, so hepatitis B can be acute or chronic, but these are the chronic viral hepatitis. Okay. We're not talking about the hepatitis that is non-viral at this point. Now we are. Okay, so non-viral hepatitis. So sometimes it's autoimmune. We don't know why, but at some point the immune system may start attacking its own hepatocytes, its own liver cells. And so just realized that my microphone was kind of messed up. It was kind of sticking off in the wrong direction. So sorry about that. I'm gonna have to go replay that and see if I have to do this all over again. Okay, so non-viral hepatitis. So the immune system may start to attack its own hepatocytes and acute fulminant. So that is hepatic failure due to hepatitis of all types that progresses to hepatic encephalopathy, or that results in mental confusion or coma. So that's usually very rapid onset, and that will occur. So this progression will occur within 2 to 3 weeks of a person, and this is a person that doesn't have chronic liver disease, so it's acute fulminant. And really, when we think of acute fulminant, one of the big things is acetaminophen toxicity. Okay, so which kind of brings us to drug metabolism in the liver. So the liver metabolizes lipid soluble, so I kind of mentioned that earlier, lipid soluble substances that cannot be directly excreted by the kidney. So and we sort of saw how, you know, the portal vein and the hepatic artery sort of fed in, and then all of these cells were kind of surrounding it. So these are hepatocytes that I'm drawing here. Okay. So these are all sort of surrounding these blood vessels that are moving through there.
And these cells are producing something called cytochrome P450s or CYP enzymes. And there are a bunch of different enzymes that are made. And they all do little things. Like one of them may take off like a CO3 group or something that's part of a bigger molecule. And that may be its job. It says, oh, I get rid of that. I decarboxylate something. And so they have to all sort of work together. And some drugs will have, its own set of these CYP enzymes that break it down, and you have to get rid of it. Where it becomes interesting is if you take two different drugs, okay, this is interesting from a pharmacology perspective. But if, let's say, CYP3A, so let's say CYP3A breaks down a schizophrenia drug. Okay, so it's responsible for breaking down a schizophrenia drug. And then CYP3A, let's say that patient also has, let's say you're also treating them for anxiety, and that particular drug also gets broken down by CYP3A, then that would be two drugs that aren't necessarily compatible because they're putting too much pressure on the liver, because you've got one enzyme that the liver is making that's supposed to now break down two different drugs. So that means that when you look at prescriptions, you may have to either increase the prescription dose, or you may have to find a different type of drug that's broken down with a different cytochrome P450 molecule, or that uses a different enzyme, liver enzyme, to break it down. Okay. So that's phase one. Phase two couples it with a substance to make it more water soluble. So that's kind of how we get into certain overdose toxicities, is when the liver isn't able to keep up as it's breaking that down. So let's see, inactivates hormones. So that's another thing these enzymes do. Inactivates hormones, insulin, glucagon, thyroxine, steroid hormones. These are all inactivated by enzymes that are made by the liver. So in the case of acetaminophen, the liver can break it down, leaving only a small amount of a toxic residue. Okay, so it's a small amount of a toxic residue, and that's not unusual when your body breaks something down, certain enzymes. It's not unusual for them to have a brief period of time where there is a toxic residue, but it knows how to deal with that too. Okay, so this toxic residue that can be combined with another molecule called glutathione and then excrete it. Okay, so no problem normally, except when you have taken too much, and then the liver can't keep up, and it builds up too much of that toxic residue, and that toxic residue can then harm the liver. So it can actually cause damage to the liver and maybe some other places. So that's acetaminophen. And alcoholic liver disease, so too much alcohol. Now the alcohol is also processed in the liver. And part of the so your body can break down alcohol. It's really not a problem for your body, for your liver, to break down alcohol in moderation. Okay, but when there is too much, or in some cases when the enzymes that you have aren't working properly, there's toxicity, free radical production that will lead to injury, inflammation, and oxidative stress. So that's the way damage happens from too much alcohol. It's actually, these free radicals are being produced, and your liver is trying to get rid of those free radicals right away. But if there's too much processing that goes on, then it's not able to, and those free radicals then can cause damage. So also, it causes a deficiency of a molecule called nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide. So NAD. Okay. NAD is an interesting thing too, because it's our lack of NAD that also may lead to aging. So that's kind of interesting. So alcohol causes a deficiency of this NAD molecule that's required for fatty acid synthesis. So when we talk about fatty acid synthesis, we're talking about triglycerides, and we say, And this is an important thing to remember, and it's something that people forget a lot because we tend to just talk about fats and triglycerides. The fatty acid are the little tails hanging down. Okay, those are the fatty acid. This whole thing here is a triglyceride. And so when we want energy, we don't use the triglyceride. We break off these fatty acids, and then we release those fatty acids. Okay, so when your body is trying to get energy, and it wants these fatty acids, then one of the responsibilities of your liver may be to produce fatty acids. And if it's unable to, or if you may take these fatty acids, break those down, and then break them down even further to make glucose. Okay, so lots of things can happen in the liver, but it needs to be able to break down these triglycerides. If it can't, which is a lot of times what happens, alcohol may cause a deficiency in this molecule that is needed to make these. And if it can't do that, then guess what? The triglycerides build up. And when the triglycerides build up, we have something called steatosis or fatty liver. Okay. So liver cells, so fatty liver, alcoholic fatty liver disease. So fatty liver cells contain fat deposits and the liver becomes enlarged. Okay, so it makes perfect sense. And it's all because it's competing with this molecule or this enzyme cofactor that is needed to release the fatty acids. It tends to be asymptomatic and resolves after alcohol intake is discontinued. Sure, why not? We're making everything properly. It's just that the alcohol is maybe competing or somehow reducing our levels of this NAD molecule. And so we alcohol intake is reduced. Well, then we can sort of go back to normal. We can get rid of this buildup of fats. Alcoholic hepatitis. Remember, hepatitis comes in, I mean, that's just that inflammation of the liver. So liver inflammation and liver cell failure. So this may be common in binge drinkers. Okay? So this is where the liver isn't able to function properly. And this may cause rapid onset jaundice. So now we have liver cell failures where the liver cells aren't doing what they're supposed to be doing because of alcohol, usually large amounts of alcohol at one particular time. And this may actually it may actually result in jaundice because the liver is sort of I don't want to say shut down, but its function is reduced enough where it can't do one of its primary jobs, and that is to get rid of these broken down blood cells as hemoglobin or as bilirubin. Okay, so the bilirubin will then build up in the body, in the blood, and cause jaundice. Now, continuing this, if you don't stop drinking and it continues, then it will develop. You will develop cirrhosis. Obviously, not everybody develops cirrhosis. Not everybody develops anything. But this is a serious problem. So cirrhosis occurs when scar tissue partially blocks the sinusoids and bile canaliculi. So all of these things that we looked at, these little vessels that were, had the cells around them. Well, when scar tissue develops, you have some damage in this area, and these things are blocked. Then you're losing liver function. You're losing liver function, and it becomes even more of a problem, right? Because now your liver that's processing the alcohol, if you don't stop giving it alcohol on a regular basis, then it will, I mean, it's almost like a positive reinforcement type of thing. It just snowballs and gets worse and worse and worse. You have less functional liver to process that alcohol, which is going to cause even more of a problem. Okay. But there are also, so we talked about alcoholic liver disease. Well, there's non-alcoholic liver disease, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. And it really is the same thing, except instead of giving alcohol to reduce the function of your liver, either, well, a lot of times we're just putting too much fat in and the liver can't keep up, if that makes any sense. So fatty infiltrates, this is the steatosis, Steatohepatitis, fatty infiltrates with inflammation. Okay, so now we've kind of moved to, so this is the steatosis is going to indicate that it's fatty. And then the hepatitis. Now we have not just fat building up, but now we've got inflammation that's occurring. And then so the inflammatory or inflammatory response has been triggered. And then that's the damage that comes with inflammation. Inflammation isn't just this nice little angel of a response. It's there to kill things, and sometimes it kills its own cells. So we may end up with hepatocyte necrosis. Okay. So it's seen with obesity. So this may be so the obesity. I mean that's an increase in lipids in general that are stored, whatever the cause of the obesity is. But there's an increase in lipids, type 2 diabetes a lot of times. So we may have some difficulty processing lipids in that case, metabolic syndrome, hyperlipidemia. But you kind of see with all of these things, you have an increase of fats, okay? Or a lot of times just these triglycerides. We've got more triglycerides either being produced or somehow, like with a metabolic issues, somehow we're not able to break these down properly. And we just call it non-alcoholic fatty liver disease because it's not the fault of the alcohol that's not able to be done. Okay. Cirrhosis. So we've been throwing around the word cirrhosis. What is cirrhosis? Cirrhosis represents the end stage of chronic liver disease in which much of the functional liver tissue is replaced by non-functioning fibrous tissue. Okay. Forms constrictive bands and disrupts flow. So in general, what are we going to say? We're going to say that cirrhosis, you've damaged the liver, and it's going to be pretty permanent because that those cells that were at one time functional have been replaced by scar tissue. Okay, replaced by scar tissue, and the scar tissue isn't going to do anything. So we say non-functioning fibrous tissue. Okay, so manifestations from asymptomatic to liver failure. So you may not notice it at first, but it's still doing damage. So early on, enlarged liver, weight loss, weakness, anorexia, ascites, pain. So all of these things can come from different processes, whether it's because you've developed anemia, because your liver isn't able to make certain factors that will then cause blood cells to be made, or a lot of times thrombocytes or platelets, and so you may end up with some kind of anemia or something like that. Lots of different things because the liver produces so many different proteins that are necessary for other processes in the body and puts them into the blood. So a lot of these things are just sort of kind of caused from that. So in later stages, when you have more and more liver damage, jaundice, portal hypertension, okay, which we're going to talk about next. Portal hypertension. So that's when the portal vein is trying to go to the liver, and the liver is maybe clogged, non-functional, and then you have and it kind of backs up, okay, backs up into the GI system. Okay, so portal hypertension, which can lead to esophageal varices, and we'll see that in a minute. And then liver failure. We're talking about damaging the liver. It's not a stretch to sort of imagine that you've had, once you've had 90% damage to the liver, you've pretty much crossed a threshold. Okay, so portal hypertension. It's a pretty straightforward kind of thing. We have increased resistance to flow in the portal venous system. So, however, for whatever reason, whatever kind of kidney damage that may be taking place, or I'm sorry, kidney, liver damage, I hope I haven't been saying kidney instead of liver the whole time. So whatever kind of liver damage that might be taking place, you're going to have a backup of blood into this portal system, okay, into the portal veins. So increased resistance to flow in the portal venous system affects veins draining into the hepatic portal system. So there are various causes. Obstruction is a big one. So that can be prehepatic, post-hepatic, intrahepatic. So kind of like when we were talking about the renal system. So that's either before the liver, after the liver, or in the liver that you can have some kind of obstruction, and it's just a backup of blood. So when that happens, the pressure in the portal veins increases, varicosities and shunts develop, releasing blood toxins to general circulation. So what does that mean? So a varicosity would mean that you have an increased blood flow that maybe isn't where there was necessarily blood before, and so it may sort of cross over into general circulation. Okay, so it's sort of the you can almost sort of think of it, it's kind of how I do, right or wrong, but I think of that as being you have this nice little closed system to begin with, and then you start to produce these vessel shunts, and it's saying, okay, well, we're trying to move it back to the liver, but we can't. So one way that we're going to release pressure is to allow that blood to sort of mix with the arterial blood. And that's a problem, right? Because the reason that it's going to the liver to begin with is because potential toxins need to be dealt with. And so by releasing it into general circulation, then you're allowing those toxins to move into general circulation. Now, one of the things that happens with the hypertension is that the organs from this hepatic portal system will engorge with blood because they can't push the blood out, so they begin to get larger. I mean, that's what's going to happen with increased blood pressure, and that can lead to a GI bleed. So we can kind of see that here in this picture. Okay, so this is an esophageal varices. These are esophageal varices, and so the blood is sort of collecting in these veins that are along the esophagus, and this is just, this is just one of the places that this is seen, a common place that this is seen, and these may burst. These may burst, and that blood may then, build up, and that's kind of, that can happen in the esophagus, it can happen to other areas, and that's where we end up a lot of times with a GI bleed. So portal hypertension can lead to that, and that's pretty much how that happens. Okay, liver failure. So now our liver, we're calling it liver failure. It's the most severe clinical consequence of liver disease, and it sounds bad. And that's when you've lost 90% of function. Now we've been talking. It's almost overwhelming. All the different things we keep coming back to, and we say, oh, well, the liver does this. Oh, the liver makes that. The liver's, it's dealing with the fat. It's dealing with the glucose. It's making clotting factors. It's making immune factors for like complement. It's doing all of this stuff. And so, yeah, you can see where it would be pretty serious when it stops. And so manifestations are going to reflect all of that. The synthesis, storage, metabolic, elimination functions of the liver, all of the stuff that it does, when you've lost 90% of function, you're going to have some deficits. Okay, hematological disorders, anemia, okay, thrombocytopenia, if you remember those clotting factors, coagulation defects, anemia may be caused because you may have some hemorrhage in certain places, any kind of damage that may take place, it may not be able to be clogged, and so now you've got increased bleeding. There are cofactors or protein factors that are involved in stimulating white blood cell production, which is not going to happen. So endocrine disorders, fluid retention, potassium, disordered sexual functions, because you're not going to be able to make steroid hormones, and that's kind of an important thing too, because cholesterol is being made by the liver and then being shuttled out of the liver to various places, so you're not going to be able to make steroid hormones. So you're going to have sexual functions disorders as well as other things that rely on those steroid hormones. Okay, so you can kind of look through here and you can kind of see some of these things we just named. Decreased cholesterol, impaired fat absorption. You can kind of go through, and now not all of these things have we specifically talked about. Hyperbilirubinemia, But we have increased androgens, estrogens, let's see, steroid hormones. So this is saying disorders of metabolic, this is saying increased androgens, estrogens. I kind of wish I hadn't read this because that doesn't make any sense to me, and I don't like that. Unless it's talking about, okay, well, I don't know. That's puzzling to me because the liver is making the cholesterol. Okay. I don't know if that's a mistake on the slide or if I'm missing some probably little simple little thing that I'm just kind of overlooking. But either way, all of these things that we've talked about are going to be affected. Okay. So don't worry, I guess I won't be able to put this on the test until I figure out why it's saying that we would have increased aldosterone and increased androgens and estrogens. There must be some kind of a signal or something that's taking place that I'm not considering right now. Okay. Let's see. Gallbladder, pancreas. Okay, so remember that the liver was making, I don't know if I drew my liver in the right direction, but was making bile. The gallbladder stores the bile. Okay, so don't forget that. Well, and the reason I say that is because people tend to say they associate with the gallbladder with bile, which you should, but it was made in the liver. Okay, so the liver produces bile, but the gallbladder stores it until fats are detected in the GI tract. We have this great little system where the large intestine says, "Oh, there's fat in here," and releases a hormone called cholecystokinin, CCK, and it goes up to the gallbladder and it says, "Hey, gallbladder, there's fat," and the gallbladder will then contract and it will push the bile out. The bile has bile salts, and these bile salts emulsify or surround these big droplets of fat and then break it down into smaller droplets so it can be digested. So when we don't have a gallbladder, or when the gallbladder is removed, we can still technically emulsify and digest fat, but you can't have a big, large, fatty meal. You might have to spread it over a long period of time, or just have a tiny, tiny little bit of fat. You really have to watch. You really have to watch how fat moves in when you don't have a gallbladder. Okay, so that's the gallbladder. The pancreas produces a broad range of digestive enzymes, and that's one of the big things that it does, is that it's got cells in the. So the pancreas has all of these little cells that are producing enzymes to break down just about everything. Okay, so that's what it's doing. The exocrine function of the pancreas is to produce enzymes that it then excretes into the intestine along with the bile. Okay, and those are then there. Those enzymes will then break down pretty much everything that we can throw at it in terms of food. Okay. So cholelithiasis or gallstones. Gallstones can be a problem. So precipitation of bile substances. So precipitation just means that it goes from a liquid form to forming a solid. Okay, kind of like the canaliculi of or the calculi or kidney stones that we talked about earlier. So, but in this case, they're made of different materials. So cholesterol is a big one. So cholesterol, precipitation of cholesterol and some other molecules are a big cause of gallstones. So 80%. So associated with obesity, women taking oral contraceptives or who have had multiple pregnancies are also more susceptible. It's seen more in them. And the other 20% calcium salts with bilirubin. Okay, so that's the other type of gallstone. That is seen. So factors that contribute to the formation, abnormalities in the composition of bile. Well, usually it's going to be an increase in some of these things, increase in calcium levels, and you know that may not necessarily be because of your diet. Some people may be able to have just lots and lots of calcium and cholesterol, and they won't form gallstones. So there's some other kind of some other kind of factor that we don't know about. Stasis of bile, when things don't move, then that gives them more of that opportunity to start that what's called nucleation, where they will start to then form that crystal, that formation of the crystal in the stone. So and inflammation of the gallbladder. Okay. So that can be both a result and can be a factor that could end with gallstones. Okay. Acute cholecystitis. Gallbladder inflammation associated with complete or partial obstruction. So inflammation caused by chemical irritation from the concentration from concentrated bile. And we're talking about inflammation because it's an itis. It's acute. Okay, so don't leave that out either. Inflammation, concentrated bile, mucosal swelling, ischemia secondary to venous congestion and lymphatic stasis. So what does all that mean? Chemical irritation from concentrated bile. Okay, so for whatever reason, when things get thrown out of a homeostasis or something, some normal amount, then that's obviously causing inflammation within the gallbladder. Mucosal swelling, ischemia, secondary to venous congestion. So now we have a lack of blood flow because of venous congestion and lymphatic stasis. Okay, so that's a lack of fluid movement. So gallbladder is usually distended, okay, which is going to then probably lead to pain. Okay, severe right upper quadrant pain after heavy meal or alcohol consumption. So it's trying to work normally, but then when we throw in anything that may cause an increase in the requirements on it, then that can cause the pain to show up. The pain may radiate to the right shoulder and scapular region, and you can't change positions to fix it. So it's not like a muscular pain or some digestive pain. It's just sort of there. Okay. So elevated serum levels. So this is something that some of these things are just things we might see. So total bilirubin. So your bilirubin may increase, which could lead to jaundice. Okay, because those things are related. Aminotransferase, alkaline phosphatases. These are just things that are produced by the liver for protein metabolism. And so we may have damage now. Things are backing up into the liver, and you may see some damage, or you may see some release of molecules that you can detect in the blood that are being released because of this. So jaundice, vomiting, fever occasionally present. So it's somehow triggering the inflammatory process, and somehow triggers the vomiting reflex. Okay. Cholecystasis. Well, when we talk about stasis, we're talking about a stoppage of flow. So in this case, cola is going to refer to liver gallbladder. So reduction or stoppage of bile flow, disorders of the liver, bile duct, or pancreas can cause cholecystasis. So this is pretty straightforward. It's a stoppage of bile flow, stoppage or a slowing, stasis. Can be caused by stones, or it can be caused by hepatitis. Okay, so if you're damaging part of the, or if you have inflammation of part of the liver where you're interrupting flow, well, there you go. That's what we're talking about. So that's kind of what we're saying is that stones, it's pretty clear. Hepatitis can also lead to sort of this reduced flow of bile. So bile flow in the liver slows down. Bile accumulates and forms plugs in the ducts. Okay, so all of these little ducts or the canaliculi, these things can get clogged up. The ducts may rupture and damage liver cells. Of course, when we have liver cells that are continually damaged, that's where we start to get into cirrhosis. Alkaline phosphatase, which is a liver enzyme, is released into the blood. Okay, so this is one of these things that we can see in the blood. The liver is unable to continue processing bilirubin, increased bile acids in the blood and skin. So here's another symptom that we see, and that's the pruritus. And it's kind of an interesting one because now we have itching. Okay, and so it's kind of interesting to say, okay, we have itching in the skin, and yet that's going to be something you're going to see, and it's kind of difficult to bring that back and say, oh, okay, well, this is actually because of a liver disorder or a gallbladder or this flow, the stoppage of flow. And so the itching is probably because bile salts now, instead of being able to be released off into the small intestine, are now backing up. And so those may back up and they may move into general circulation. And so that's one of the ideas, is that maybe they're collecting in the skin. So the bile salts may be actually moving into the skin and causing the pruritus or itching. Okay, so acute pancreatitis. So now we're going to talk about the pancreas briefly. Acute pancreatitis and autodigestion of the pancreas. Well, that just sort of makes sense. We have a pancreas that is making every enzyme to everything that we eat, whether it's an animal's pancreas or our own pancreas that we're eating. What happens is that the pancreatic duct leaves enzymes trapped in the pancreas, and then they become active. And since their job is to break down food, suddenly they can't tell the difference between the proteins and lipids of its own pancreas versus whatever it's supposed to be breaking down. And so those activated enzymes start to digest the pancreas cells. Sounds horrible. So severe pain results. Inflammation produces large volumes of serous exudate and hypovolemia. Pancreatic enzymes will then start to appear in the blood, which is also not so good. But hopefully they're dilute enough that they're not going to dissolve your whole body. So pancreatic enzymes, amylase, lipases, you'll find those in the blood. Areas of cells will undergo fat necrosis when triglycerides are broken down into fatty acids. Well, that just sort of makes sense. So you start to break down fats, and those fats are kind of needed for those cells to function, and so those cells are going to die. Okay? And so that's where we have fat necrosis. And calcium from blood will deposit into these dying cells and causing hypocalcemia from the blood. So the calcium is leaving the blood and moving into these calcified necrotic cells. Okay, so causing hypocalcemia because the calcium isn't staying where it's supposed to be staying. So, and you're going to see pain, nausea, fever, swelling in the upper abdomen. So some of these similar symptoms. Okay, so chronic. So remember, this one that we were just talking about was acute. I'm not sure if I made a deal about that versus chronic. And of course, we by now hopefully know the difference. When we're talking about chronic, we're talking about something that is progressive, or we're talking about something that lasts, that remains. So progressive and permanent destruction in this case. Have signs and symptoms similar to acute. It's just that instead of resolving, it's continuing and it's progressing, and it's going to cause permanent destruction. Okay, so often have digestive, yeah, well, I mean, this makes sense. If you've got the pancreas, which isn't working right, oh, and we've added pancreatic cancer, so pancreatic cancer is going to lead to this too. So chronic pancreatitis, pancreatic cancer, digestive problems because of the inability to deliver enzymes to the duodenum or duodenum, however you want to say that. Yeah, these enzymes that are supposed to be breaking things down, you can't. It's going to cause digestive problems. Glucose control. Remember, I know that we're talking mainly about exocrine. So exocrine is where it's released into the lumen of an organ, or outside the body in some cases. Endocrine is where it's released into the blood. So this is an endocrine problem, and we're talking about our alpha cells and our beta cells. So, glucose problems because of damage to the islets of Langerhans. These are the alpha and beta cells that are making insulin and, that's supposed to say insulin and glucagon. So that can be a problem. So signs of biliary obstruction. Okay, so now we have bile that isn't able to move through because of underlying bile tract disorders or duct compression by tumors. Okay, so now we have a pancreas problem that is also sort of affecting other organs around it, namely the gallbladder and liver region. Okay. Okay. So this was, yeah, again, we're talking about chronic, whereas before we were talking about acute pancreatitis and pancreatic cancer. So pancreatic cancer is another thing that's going to cause all of these issues. Okay, which kind of makes sense given the function of the pancreas. Okay, well that's it for this section or this chapter.